Sabita, and my mother was a World War II bride. My dad met her in Italy, and so we were raised with a lot of Italian food. And one of our favorite foods was focaccia bread, and that's what I'm going to make for you today. So we're going to start with, when you do focaccia, you want to make sure what kind of flour you got, because I tried it with all-purpose flour. I hadn't made it for a long time, so I did some experimenting. And it really is best to make with bread flour. It comes out better if you buy bread flour. And Fleischmann's yeast, I'm a big fan of this yeast. It really helps rise. This is Fleischmann's yeast rising right now for us. So, but here's how you get it started. You put in 1 teaspoon of sugar, and then you put in your yeast. Cup of flour or water, flour, water, and then you just stir it, and then you let it sit. And what happens is you let it sit for at least 10 minutes minimum, or at least until it doubles like this. This is what it should look like after 10 minutes of rising. You want your yeast to be activated. So as you can see right now, it's just a little bit of water in the yeast. Okay. Then the next step is to get 4 cups of flour, and I've already pre-measured it. So there's 4 cups of flour in here, and you take 1 teaspoon of salt, and you put it in the flour, and then you stir it up really well to get the salt all over the place. You know, you've got to stir it up so you can get this flour and the salt combined. And then I usually make a little pocket in the bottom, and then I take the yeast that's been risen. This is about 10, it usually takes about 10 minutes to get it to get this fluffy. Okay, then you just pour it in. Okay, and then we need 2 tablespoons of olive oil. You put that in here. And what I like to do with this first warm yeast is to stir that a little bit in the middle to get the olive oil in with a little bit of water first. And then you just start stirring and get it as wet as you can. And I have noticed that when you use all-purpose flour, the recipe calls for 1.5 cups of flour, but you might have to use more water. And I'm hoping that this case it seems kind of dry today. I don't know. But if I need more water, they're going to have to heat it up. And it is heated up water. You want to have a warm water for your yeast. And then what I do to make sure I get all the yeast, whatever I raise it in, I take the water first and kind of like make sure I get all the yeast out of the bowl so I'm not losing any of the yeast. And then we'll see how that works with the water. And it's still on the dry side. So we're going to keep adding water. And I know this is 1.5 cups here, so I'm just going to go pretty much use all this water. Okay. And you just keep stirring. And you just... The focaccia bread should be more on the moist side than the, like a regular ball bread dough. It should be wet. And I don't think I have a little water with me. Let's try here. And you have to excuse me, sometimes I get messy. I'm a messy cook. I'm not a nice, neat, what you see on TV. I usually have flour all over me, flour on the floor, flour on my clothes, flour on my shoes. But then what you do is once you get it kind of stirred up, then you just want to kind of get all that flour in there. And you don't have to knead this like you do regular bread. You just get it all moistened up, get all the flour in there somehow, and just keep doing it until you can get all the flour into the dough. And then once you get that all in, and you can see it's not a smooth round ball, it's rough looking, okay? But it's wet and moist. So then what you do, once you get it, is kind of like make a ball. And then what I do is I put a little bit of olive oil in here to keep it from sticking to the sides. Because it will stick because there is a lot of moisture in it. And it will stick. So put a little bit of olive oil on there. And this, you let it sit for an hour. And you let it double. And this is what it looks like when you double it. And just like my mom, I use my little white cloth to cover up my bread bowl. I still have those kind of things that I do as my mother. And you can see the yeast already starting to rise and getting fluffy. But this is the bread dough after an hour, and it has doubled. So you let it double. And you can see from this first bowl the difference. This is the first. There's your difference. You want it to double. Okay, then when it's doubled, you take the bread, get your pan, and you coat your pan with olive oil. I brought a brush, but normally I use my own finger. You know. Good Italian mother, don't use all these fancy things. You just go, you know. Like I said, when I'm at home, it's different at home, but I have to be professional today. And then they coat the sides of the pan so it's all nice and wet with olive oil. And once you get it all coated, you then get your bread dough. And to make it easier to get out, you start on one end and bring it back to you. Okay, and you see how it went. And then you just put it in the pan. And you use your fingers. You don't, like I said, you have no rolling in this. This is all fun food, you know. You get to use your hands. You get to play. It's like the first time I ever made bread, I was 5 years old. I kept crying, I want to make bread, I want to make bread. And my nonna, Italian grandmother, she lived with us, and she spoiled me. She spoiled me. And I kept crying, and Mom kept saying, no, 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 no. And so finally she let me do it, and she gave me the focaccia bread when it was still, like, really wet, and maybe put water on it, and it got all the, and it was sticking, and I start crying, and she says, no. She made me finish. But I was so proud of that little loaf of bread. So what you do is you take your fingers and you just literally just poke your fingers in the bread dough. And I'm going to hold this up. I think you can see it. I'm not sure, but I will hold it up for you. And you just poke a bunch of holes in it. And it looks like that. Okay. And then you take a little bit of, whoa, it slid on me. I've got to put it back. And then you just take olive oil and coat it with olive oil. Olive oil is what makes the focaccia bread. And I use Bertolli because that's what my mother used. So I would have used that Robin Hood flour, but I found out there's Robin Hood flour is only available in Canada, and you have to pay to get it shipped here. So nobody sells it. And that's the finished product with that. So then you let that sit to the side for 20 minutes, and it should double. And once it's double, you put it in an oven at 400 degrees, and you bake it for 20 minutes. And then it comes out looking like this. This is a finished product. Okay. And then one thing fun about focaccia bread is you can do a lot of things with focaccia bread. And if you're invited to a party and somebody says, what do you want to bring? And you say, well, I'll bring the bread. Okay, you can make some focaccia bread. And I got creative last night. And you can do something like this to take to a party. And what I did with this was you put, when it goes like this, after it rose and doubled, I put the tomatoes and the rosemary and the black olives on, and that's how it came out. So, and that's something that you can use at a party. So I found my new thing now. Somebody says, come on over, I'm going to make focaccia bread. So, and that's it. Any questions? You have any questions? Pretty simple. It's pretty, you know, easy to do. It's one of the easiest breads to make. And then you can see, just a few minutes we've been talking, how much that yeast has risen. Yes. 13 by 9. Always use a 13 by 9 pan. I tried to make one in a bigger pan and went flat. It looked more like breadsticks instead of focaccia bread. But no, these are all 13 by 9 pans, and it comes out perfectly. And I tried doubling the dose the other day, and it's too hard to, it's so sticky, it's too hard to divide it evenly, so I do one dose at a time. Any other questions? Well, thank you for your time. I hope you enjoyed watching the bread being made. We're going to clean up here and get ready for the next presenter.
My name is Anita Massarelli Smigel, and I am going to demonstrate the Italian butter cake. And I had this cake when I was just a small child. My mother used to make it all the time. And it's very easy to make, even though it's from scratch. And it's in your book. If you have your book, it's on page 92. But if you have your menu, it should be on the back of the menu. Okay, the first thing you're going to do is grease and flour a bun pan, a two pan. If you don't have one of these, I have done it in a 9 by 13 pan, but you have excess batter, so you might want to make like 6 cupcakes besides a 9 by 13. Heat your oven to 350 degrees, and then you mix your flour and your baking powder together first, and I have it already measured out. It takes 3 cups of flour, and this is 4 teaspoons of baking powder. So you want to mix that together and let it set. Just regular flour, not cake flour. I'm using gold medal today, but you can use any kind of flours, but not cake flour. You cream your sugar and your butter, and it calls for 2 cups of sugar, and I have it measured out. I'm going to put it in the large bowl, and 2 sticks of butter. And it has to be room temperature so that it will blend. Now I'm going to get a little noisy because that mixer is going to be running for a while. Just make sure the big lumps are broken up. It may not get real creamy. Okay, then after you get that taken care of, we're going to go to, I'm going to add 1 egg at a time, and they need to be room temperature also. And I have an egg in each one of these containers. And this will kind of blend that sugar and butter together once it gets moist.
Egg
Once you get that in there, your batter is going to be kind of runny. It's just going to have sugar, butter, and eggs in it. Then you do your milk, and it has to be room temperature. So I have it sitting under there so it would get warm. You add your milk, and then you beat it for a while. 1 cup. Okay, now once that's mixed up, now you're going to add your dry ingredients, which is your flour and your baking powder. And this can be made in double batches. We've tried it. It works well if you have to make 2 cakes. Once that's almost blended together, it'll look like this. You're going to add your vanilla, and we have almond flavor. That's what it calls for in the recipe. But you could add whatever flavor you want. If you don't like almond, you can do a double vanilla. This is the vanilla. This is the almond. You could put rum flavoring, whatever you decide to put in there. That's fine. Now you have to beat it for 2 minutes. I want to scrape my bowl a little, make sure I get it all in there. This batter kind of grows as you beat it. It gets bigger and bigger, and it gets real thick. It isn't like a regular box cake mix. It's important that you beat it for 2 minutes. Some people say, my cakes never come out right. That's because they're not mixing it the proper amount of time. Everything has to be whipped and blended. You want to get those eggs all whipped up in there. Okay. Now this is what it's going to look like. It's very thick. As you can see, it doesn't run out of the pan. I'm going to put it in the bundt pan. I should show you as it comes out of the bowl because it's real thick. That's all that butter in there and those eggs that whipped it up. Now, it calls for a baking time of an hour, but it depends on your oven. If your oven's really hot, you need to bake it less. And if you have a convection oven, you need to turn it down 25 degrees because it's too hot for this cake. Because it's a thick cake and it has to bake evenly. Now I've spread this out. And this is what your bud pan will look like. And it's ready to go in the oven. That's what it looks like. It's going to be about 3/4 full, but it'll rise probably clear up to the top of this bundt pan. Okay, now, I made a mess too. I'll show you the finished product. This is what it'll look like when it's done. And that's what it'll look like. Now, you need to test it if you think your oven's a little hot. Test it 50 minutes, test it, put a toothpick in it. And if it looks like it's not done, put it in for 5 to 7 more minutes. And if it looks like it does, take it out right away. Put it on a cooling rack in the pan for 10 minutes. It'll finish cooking in the pan. And once it sets for 10 minutes, just flip that pan over on a cooling rack. It'll take probably 3 hours to cool because it's so thick. Now, you can drizzle any kind of topping you want on it. You can do chocolate if you want to drizzle chocolate over it. You can use a glaze. You can slice it and put fruit on it. It's very versatile. Today, we are serving it iced with baker's icing, and it'll have almond and vanilla flavoring in it. So it'll enhance the cake. So that's what you're having for dessert today. Is there any questions from anybody? Yes, sir. They say no because flour causes salmonella, so you can't know. You can lick the icing beaters. Any other questions? Yes. Oh, you use whole milk. Now, we've made it with 2% milk, and we've made it with imperial margarine instead of butter. They both come out well as far as the cake itself, and the taste isn't, it's not bad either, but when it calls for butter, you're going to get a richer, browner cake. That's why we use butter in this recipe. But you can substitute if you don't have whole milk. You can use 2%, but it'll work. It's just going to be the same quality, but it'll taste the same. Any other questions? Okay. Thank you so much. I appreciate your time.
Welcome to our Italian vegetable cooking class. We are going to Sicily. We will be making eggplant caponata, which is a Sicilian dish. Did you know that 90% of eggplant grown in Italy is grown in Sicily? Did you know that 66% of the eggplant grown in the world is grown in the United States? You want to guess the state? You would think that. Second guess, Florida, maybe? No. It is grown in, you ready for this? New Jersey. 66% of the world's eggplant. Eggplant likes sandy, loamy soil. New Jersey has sandy soil. So I want to read a quick little thing to you. You know, eggplant has not a good reputation.
My name is?
I am so sorry. My name is Teresa Mowry.
And I'm Irene Oda.
See how we talk too much? Anyhow, I'm going to read this to you because I couldn't memorize it. And this is just a little thing off of the internet that tells you the nutritional value of eggplant, even though a lot of people think thumbs down on eggplant. Nutritional value: ample amounts of vitamins, minerals, antioxidants, fiber. Eggplant aids in digestion, prevents anemia, regulates blood sugar, promotes healthy bones, enhances brain function, not that we all don't need that, and in certain instances can reduce the risk of some cancers. So it's a very nutritious edible. Now we're going to go shopping and we're going to buy our eggplants. Not easy to find good eggplants. When you shop for an eggplant, there are probably four main things. An eggplant should have a nice shiny purple color. It should be firm to touch. It should be shiny. And when you look at the bin of eggplants in the store, pick them up. Because you pick them all up because you want to choose the eggplant that is the heaviest. And the reason for that is it, the flesh is young and hydrated, and it's probably the freshest eggplant in that bin. The other thing that you need to look at is the stem. The stem should be green, but because our eggplant comes from New Jersey or somewhere, ours is usually brown. You know, we can't find a good green stem on an eggplant, but that's indication of a really fresh eggplant. And the last thing is it should feel firm to touch. If it feels mushy, then there's damage inside. There's going to be some bad spots in there, so you don't want to pick that. So the next thing is we're going to talk about, I was going to use this as a prize for whoever guessed where the eggplant was made. The poor little crooked deformed eggplant. So the next thing we're going to talk about is, you know, we've made several batches of this eggplant. And the recipe tells us to make 1/2 inch squares. So we did a recipe with 1/2 inch squares. And some people thought it was eggplant forward because the eggplant was too small and maybe mushed up and you couldn't taste it. But there are people out there that say, I don't like eggplant, but if you gave them this dish, they would not know they were eating eggplant. Seriously, don't tell your husbands. And so then we did it again and we made the pieces bigger. And that time, because eggplant is very porous, it soaked up kind of like it was tomato forward. So, you know, there are at least 37 different eggplant recipes that we've run across, and you're going to make your caponata to your taste, to whatever you like to eat. So I'm cutting this, and I'm just cutting a little bit off the bottom so I can flatten this and I don't cut my finger off. And so I'm trying to make 1/2 inch pieces. Am I going to be successful? I don't know, ladies. I'm trying. So then I'm going to go this way again. You know, you watch those cooking shows on TV and inevitably somebody cuts themselves. I had my husband sharpen this knife for me and then I thought, what was I thinking? So I'm missing a bowl.
And a knife.
I have a knife. Knock, knock.
Knock, knock. I need a bowl and a knife. I need a knife.
And I need a bowl.
And a bowl.
A small bowl.
Small bowl.
And honestly, all I'm going to do with the bowl is put this eggplant in it that is not really... You know how the cooking shows, they go crazy if everything's not perfectly evenly.
I need a knife that cuts.
I'm
going to
salt it.
I'm going to
put olive oil on it. I'm going to stir it. I'm going to put it on this sheet pan, and I'm going to put it through the window for them to bake it at 425 to 450 degrees until golden brown and turning every 15 minutes. And it probably took us a good 35 to 45 minutes. To complete the process. So, okay, now we're moving on to Irene, who is actually going to make caponata.
We're using an electric skillet, and we're using it, and we ended up cooking, when we originally made several of the recipes, we did it at home, and we made each recipe that you're seeing separately. We did not make multiple recipes because it truly makes a lot, and we wanted to be able to control it. As Teresa said, the one thing that she changed was the size. We use olive oil. And if you follow your recipe, that's the first thing beyond, and it says 1/4 cup divided. I generally do not measure my 2 tablespoons. As you saw, I drizzled my olive oil in. The first thing we have to do is you have to cook your celery. So we have our celery cut up, and it's pre-measured. You're not going to see me cooking it because it has to cook for a full 4 minutes. After you cook your celery, and it gets slightly brown, I cook this in about 225, 250 on my stove. I just cooked it till it was medium. My skillet was medium, and it was just a little bit of olive oil until it browned. After 4 full minutes of your celery, you're going to add your onion, and you chop up your onion, and it says fine. And the reason fine, and you will see what I have here, there it is. It cooks up real nice and fine. We went ahead and pre-cooked this because this recipe takes longer than all because we're adding so many things. So as we do the cooking, the first thing has to sit. So we have already jumped ahead to this the second part, which is you can start adding. Well, we did it a couple different ways. And the best way is if on the recipe it says add your eggplant. And this is the eggplant that was already cooked. And all your other ingredients. But really, it's better if your eggplant cooks just slightly ahead of adding the rest of the things. Now, I'm going to talk about what we did, and for every recipe that we made, we did exactly what you are seeing. We took our green olives. Now, I have 2 different kinds of green olives. We went to a couple of the stores, and we bought the regular pitted-free green olives that were plain. And then when we went back, we saw the green olives that had the pimento. So what you're going to taste, you're going to have a mixture of both because we like the look of the pimento doesn't change it other than the fact that we have some red. So we use both, but we use the amount of green olives. And then we also use the Calamani olives, which is the dark olive. I was able to find the Calamani olives already sliced. That was wonderful. That's a big help. The first couple times we made it, we had to slice our own olives. So what you're doing next then is the other ingredients. So I'll tell you about the other ingredients and Teresa can stir. So some of the things are, and I brought this to tell you, the recipe calls for diced plum tomatoes. If you go to the store, and pretty much in this High Valley, you'll go to the store and you'll find diced tomatoes. Plum tomatoes, you do not find diced. Now, I brought DeLello's, and DeLello's is what we used. My preference is Cento. Cento is it says on the can, they guarantee they're San Marzano. This says San Marzano, and it says whole-peeled Italian tomatoes, and it says San Marzano style. The Cento is actually guaranteed that they're San Marzano. But if you use a different tomato, your whole Campanada will taste totally different. So we used San Marzano. We bought the whole one, and we made our own, and it's extremely messy. But we did. Now, it says the other things that you can put in. So the other things are the Calamari, as I told you, are capers. So it tells you to take the capers, and I have a little measuring. 1.5 tablespoons of capers, rinse them, drain them, and you add the capers. And then you're going to use tomato paste. If I can find Cento, so I want to tell you about our tomato paste. This is very flavorful. If you use the kind, I know you can buy it in a can, but I prefer the tube. And again, Senta is my favorite. This is extremely flavorful. When we made it the first time, we used a definite full tablespoon like this. It was a little too much. So for tomato paste, what you need to do is when you make it, make sure you taste it, because if it has a heavy flavor, you may not want to use quite as much of that. So we have altered every time we've made it. We've made a lot. Salt. So here's our tomato paste that we would have used in there. It does call for sugar. What we did ahead, because to take all this stuff and mix it, we actually just cut our tomatoes, put our cut tomatoes, all of our other ingredients that we showed you, and put it in there. So I'm going to lift this up slightly so you can see what we have. So as it's cooking, so when it's cooking, it's absolutely beautiful. You see the reds, the greens. The other thing that it asks you at the end, it tells you, when we did our onion, by the way, we also put garlic in it. We chopped garlic, so when we cooked our onion, it was chopped garlic and onion. It says so in the group. And then it says you can use your minced fresh parsley. So we have our minced fresh parsley. And adds on the bottom. And the first couple of recipes that we made, it says a dash of sweet red wine.
That was our favorite part.
We did, but we didn't use it the first couple times. And I want to tell you, the best thing about the recipe, it sounds weird, and I mentioned this to Tony, the dash red wine makes a difference. If you want to know the difference, we made it with and without, we liked it both ways. The other best thing about this recipe that we like, now as this cooks, this has to cook for 15 minutes. As it cooks for 15 minutes, it will get, and I said, this is one of the things that we like. It's a very fragrant smelling, and it is vegetarian. No meat, anything in there. Very healthy for you. But the best thing is, the longer it sits, the better the smell. The longer it sits, the taste actually goes in. So we first couple times I made it, we made it and put it in the refrigerator. And then I wanted everybody here at the Suns to taste it. Teresa brought it, so they tasted it cold. We decided we liked it better cold. So as you make it, you can make it warm, room temperature, cold, but every time we've changed things around. We've not gone to a different tomato, though. So we have changed a little bit of our other ingredients, but not the tomato. We definitely made sure we used the plum tomato. And the wine.
Not really. Are you done?
Yeah.
Are we done? Finished product. And so, you know, there's so many variations. You could put peppers, you could put mushrooms, you could put whatever your preference is. But the end, on to lesson four. Thank you for coming. Thank you.
I did want to mention one thing. We gave you the recipe we used, but any of you that had the first cookbook from here, we have a lady here that has one of them. It is a tan cookbook. In that book, there's a recipe from Father Sam Soprano, and it's this very similar, not exactly the same, but his recipe's in there for the eggplant campanada.
Okay. Oh. You did the best.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. That's a good question, and I can address that, because yes. When I talked to you about eggplants, we bought 16 small eggplants. If you buy big eggplants, then you almost have to cut it, take the flesh, put salt on it, let it sit for an hour, and that takes some of the liquid and some of the bitterness. Eggplant, no, there's no denying it can have a bitter quality. So we didn't do that because we use small eggplants.
And it's a world of difference. If we could not believe how nice it was, because we did that the first couple of times, salted it and left it in the sink because we're thinking, but it was so dense that there was not a lot of water in it. So that was the most wonderful thing of all. So it was good doing it. Many, many times. We made many recipes to figure out what would be the best. Any other questions? Well, it actually takes probably half hour, 45 minutes the whole time, if you already have everything cut up. And we really had everything cut up for every recipe. But it takes more than the 15 minutes, because the first two ingredients itself take 10.
The next guy, I'll take it.
Oh, yeah. Texture's not the same.
You can. I mean, it is. But some people might want the fiber. I don't know. You can.
But we didn't. Yeah.
You can. It's tough.
Yeah. Pardon? Well, you know what? We didn't do it because when you see it, when it's first done, there's chunks of tomato, and you wouldn't have that chunk. And we have actually seen the Campanata. Cindy had some that's in the jar already, and they may have used crushed tomatoes because they're all mixed in. But when you make it, you'll see the chunkiness, and we all like the chunkiness. That you could see the tomato. Yeah. Any other questions over here? Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
You ready for some gnocchi? How many here have eaten gnocchis?
Wow.
How many has made them? Just about as many, huh? Barb, you never made gnocchis? Well, we're going to start. I'm going to tell you a little bit about the history of gnocchis. They're like, you could call them dumplings. But the gnocchi, that's your knuckle. That's the size of the gnocchi. That's where it came from. And every recipe that you've seen so far does not follow exact recipes in the book, because Italians don't do that. You know, I grew up helping my mother, my grandfather, and they knew, of course, everybody's mother does the best. But I want to say that when you talk to mom and say, well, how do you make your sauce? Well, I put the tomato and I put this and I taste them, and pretty soon it's good. Well, a friend of mine that I grew up with moved to California, and recently he texted me, says, can I have your mother's sauce recipe? I said, there isn't any. You know, it's how she felt that day. You taste it. Tomatoes don't all taste the same. You know, so if you wanted a certain sweetness, if you wanted a little more bold, that's up to what the ingredients you can get that time of year. So we used what we had, what was available. Now, with gnocchis, you can make them with potatoes, which is probably typical. Or you could use ricotta cheese. Now, I did them both here recently. The ricotta cheese seems like it's a lot quicker because you don't have to cook anything. You don't have to rice anything. You barely have to mix it, but you should dry it. Take a piece of cheesecloth, put the ricotta on there, especially if it's fresh, and squeeze it out. Get the liquid out of it. Because even with potatoes, the more moisture you have, the more flour you need to mix. The more flour you need, the heavier the gnocchis are. So years ago, I made probably 40 pounds of gnocchis and took them to work and fed the whole crew. A couple of these guys are big, strong guys, and they says to me, I told them, I said, just eat a little bit. I'm going to eat all the I want. I'm hungry. I can eat a lot. Well, heck, they could have went to sleep after they ate because they didn't do hardly anything. Gnocchis, these ones were made with russet potatoes, which are a little heavier. I prefer Yukon Gold. The Yukon Gold potato is what we made here. And so we're going to start, and recipes say so many cups of flour, so many pounds of potatoes. Again, your potatoes aren't always the same as moisture content. How long did you cook them? How much moisture in them? You can see I'm using this tray because this is going to get messy for me. The rule of thumb is you use as much flour as you use potato. So I made here 1 cup of, or 1 pound of potato. You're all familiar with this tool? Okay. You're not? This is a ricer. Okay. Now you can use a ricer or you can use a mixer. But this gives you some of the creamiest potatoes. See how that comes out of there? I mean, it's really different. We are going to rice 1 pound of potato here. It'd be nice if they had longer handles. Make it easier. But you don't have to put that much in. This recipe I'm going to show you is probably my favorite for gnocchis. It's not like making spaghetti. It's not like making rigatoni. It's just plain old gnocchis. And it's probably some of the sweetest pasta I've ever eaten. Now you can see this is the flour that I use. It's unbleached. And it's got a lot of protein in it compared to other flours. I don't like to use just regular run-of-the-mill flour. This bread flour, unbleached, and it's delicious when you make your meals. Okay, there's the rice to potato. If I had another potato, I'd let you try it. Now we start and we try to mix. And like I said, I use this tray because this is going to get messy. There's no amount of flour that you can measure as far as I am. The recipes all call for 3.5 pounds of potatoes and 3 or 4 cups of or pounds of flour. Right, 3 or 4? That's not a recipe, right? That's my mother's recipe. You know, you put this all together. Of course, you need a little bit of binder. So you try to get an egg. A lot of people just use the whole egg. I try, if it doesn't work out, to use the egg yolk. And then I try to save the white in a different bowl. Because instead of using olive oil to mix and bind this, we're just going to go ahead and use the egg. If I need more moisture, then all I'll need is some egg white. And this definitely needs some more moisture. I wonder if I couldn't find it. We're going to mix, and it should end up in a ball. This one is giving me a little trouble, so I need a lot more moisture. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to add another chicken embryo right here. See how solid this is going to get. This ball needs work, so what we do, I'm used to making a lot bigger one at a time. Roll it over and fold it. And you'll press this into a beautiful little ball. And once you get it where you want it, a lot of times when I'm making a bunch, I'll take the dough that I make, separate it, because you can only use handle so much at a time, put it in the refrigerator and let it chill. And it comes out, it's so much easier to work with. So this dough is just about ready. If you can feel it, it feels a lot like Play-Doh. You know, it's got a lot of gluten in it now. You've mixed it and you've pressed it. Oh, you know the rule of gluten. The more gluten you eat, the gluten goes to your glutes. And so this is what we have. I am going to take a little knife here, separate some of this for you. I'm not going to do a whole bunch of it. Make a ball, stick it out, and you start rolling it. You roll it into a gnocchi. Sometimes you can make them half inch. Sometimes you make them 3/4 inch thick. It's up to you. It's all different. Look at this. It's going to be so good. These are the base gnocchi recipe. Now you can cut them. A lot of people use this. Just this. They put it in boiling water. I don't do that. This is, you ever know what this is? You see it? It's a gnocchi board. There's fine ridges cut in here. Okay? So you set this down, and you roll them out. Now it looks like something you bought at the store that's been frozen. Okay? But there's a catch to it. That also allows the sauce to stick to it. You have ridges, and the sauce stays with it. Most everybody used the tomato sauce, spaghetti sauce. And you can do it with tomato sauce. You can do it also with olive oil, garlic, a little bit of basil in with it. So you can make them any size you would like. And, of course, when you do it by hand, unless you're an Italian lady like my mother was, they're all different sizes, which means what? They're going to cook quicker with the smaller ones, the shorter ones. The bigger ones will cook a little longer. And how do you know when they're done? When you stick them in boiling water, they float to the top, right? And once they float to the top, you take them out. And I would suggest immediately putting them in your sauce. And the sauce is warm, sitting right next to your pot. You're going to have a meal of gnocchi, homemade Italian gnocchi. Now, there's also additives. I didn't bring it up because our recipes in the book didn't bring it up. I've made it with ricotta, but I added garlic powder. I added some dried basil, turned it just a little speckly green. My wife liked those better than the plain ones, because they have a little more flavor, different flavors to them. So that is your basic gnocchi. I hope you try these at home. You'll need a vacuum sweeper and a broom and everything else to get this done. But again, Italian gnocchis, they're very easy to eat. It's a peasant dish from South Italy. There wasn't, what did you use? An egg and some flour, And sometimes they use olive oil instead. I use the chicken embryos. And they are very, very tasty. And I'll accept any questions you have. Donna? Same recipe volumes, they say. 50-50. 50-50. Whatever kind the amount of regatta you use, that's the amount of flour you should use. Usually, I have a big board that you can spread the flour all out and mix it. But once you're done, you can dust them like so. Put them on a tray and put them in the freezer. Because at home, you've made probably 200 of them now, right? And you can't eat 200 of them unless you're having a big party. So you can put them in a tray, put them in a freezer, half hour, depends on the temperature, and then you can put them in a bag and save them. And they'll be just as good. Mm-hmm. I'd use olive oil. Yeah. But again, I always use the eggs because actually my daughter raises chickens and I can get all the eggs I want. Olive oil, I got to go buy. But I prefer the eggs. How about anybody else? Who's made them? Sam? Excuse? What about it? Oregano. Yeah, if you want to. These recipes are versatile. However you like your flavor, like I told you. And you've seen the other recipes that came here. You can look in the book and you can see what guidelines you have, but you do it according to your flavor. And oregano, basil, any kind of dried herb like that you can use. Okay? We're going to cook up. We made several pounds of them here the last few days. So they're in the refrigerator, they're in the freezer getting ready to cook.
Some kind of meat today, okay? A pork roast of all the things. It's not one of my recipe, but it's found in your book, the blue book, and page 70. And I have to tell you the story about why I chose that recipe. But there was a little story, the next street down here on Belmont Street, DiNardo. Bob DiNardo and his friend, his wife Frances, owned the store. So I came over in 1968 to Benwood. And my uncle, every Saturday, walked across the Bellaire Bridge and faced toward Union Street. We went down to Delilah's to buy a couple of loaves of bread. And then he said, we're going to stop at DiNardo to get some sausages. Okay, and it was a long argument about the sausage because he didn't want to pay the price for the simple reason when he mixed the pork, he put crushed ice in the pork. And he said, you have to give me a discount because it weighs more with the ice in it. So we are all the way across the river. But anyhow, every weekend, he served one of these pork butts. You know, that like a pork roast like it's here, and he cooked it there and on Saturday. And on Sunday, when he went over there, you could have got a sandwich. The pork was not hot. It was just cold, but he made sandwiches out of leftover pork butt. And I'll tell you a little bit about myself. I came here in Benwood in 1968. I came from a small village in Italy called Arpina, 60 miles southeast of Rome, up on the top of the mountain. But I attended school, I graduated from Italy, in Sora, which it was in the valley. So I was never involved in cooking in anything in Italy, okay? My mom done all the cooking. Men doesn't cook in Italy. unless you go to the chef school and you want to learn how to cook. But usually it's all women, no men. And one thing I learned when I was in Italy, men doesn't do dishes in Italy. They do not do dishes. Women have to do all of that. After all, they do the cooking, so they said the women have to do the dishes. But anyhow, that's what I got to taste this roast that he made, which it was not like the one you usually taste when you go to Rome. Porchetta is a young pig which is put on a rotisserie in Rome, and they put it in the window. So any place you want to get a panino with porchetta, you go there, and they give you a small bun with some of the pork in here, and it's served cold. So today I'm going to demonstrate to you how we cook this porchetta according to the recipe. Okay, it's an easy recipe. As I said, it came from Bob DiNardo and Francis. And first of all, it takes very little ingredients to cook this. Okay, this is rosmarina. It's rosemary. It's rosemary, fresh rosemary. And this is the dried rosemary. Why I prefer the fresh rosemary if you have it? The smell is unbelievable. The smell goes away after you. So if you would put just dry rosemary, you have to use twice as much to get the same smell. Okay, that's the difference. Now, of course, you got an Italian seasoning. You see these in every store. Every Italian they mix sauce, they use Italian seasoning, the dry Italian, which it's a mixture: oregano, basil, parsley, and then rosemary in here, and they dry it all out. Okay, and then of course you need garlic. Garlic is one. It's another one. You could buy the mince of garlic any place in the jar, but they don't have the smell as the fresh garlic. This particular roast that I cooked today, pork roast, I use the garlic out of my garden, and this garlic came directly from the central of Italy. Somebody gave me the seed it probably was 20 years ago, and I still have that same seed, and I usually put them in the ground in November, and they grow all winter. Then you pick them about the end of June, July. So that's about the smell of garlic from your garden. It makes the roast, okay? Then, of course, good old salt, pepper, and salt. That's what you need for this recipe. Okay, so we're going to begin by it's not a pork butt. We want to get some kind of better meat than the pork butt. Pork butts are really cheap. And that's not the butt of the pig, but it's the end of the ham, you know. So they want the ham, they want to save it for prosciutto, they dry it out. That's the most expensive part of the pig. But the end of that prosciutto, that's where you get the pork butt to make sausages. That's just the meat. Some people use pork shoulder. It's the same thing. But the pork loin is part of the back of the pig. It's a fillet that comes from the back of the pig. It's a pork loin. So first, what do you do with this here? Okay, before you do anything, you have to do this the night before. Okay? You have to marinate it overnight until the next day. Otherwise, it does not get the flavor of what you put in here. The first thing, I don't use measuring cups or whatever, but the Italian use a pinch. Pinch of salt, another pinch of salt. Oh, okay, they do by pinch, that's a pinch. Then they go and they get pepper, same way. You gotta have the pinch. So now I just put it on here. It's not too hard to get it out of here, so I get it. But then you turn it over and do the same thing in the back. Same thing, pepper in the back of the roast. Very good, and you do that. Then, how you put the rest of the ingredients in here? Okay, you get a knife, and you have to cut little slits on the top of that roof. Cut little slits in here, okay? And you do that, and now you're ready to put the rest of the seasoning in here. And I'll put this over here. And first of all, you have to get... Wait a minute, I put this on here because I need the board. So you put the garlic, and usually to get a garlic, you can mash them with the knife. Mash them down. You know, you're mashing the garlic down instead of trying to chop it up. You mash it down, and... Oh, this smells good. And then what you do, this is already washed, but you pull this out. Rosemary comes out of this, the fresh rosemary I grew in the back of my yard. And now I'm not going to use all of it today, but I just want to show you. Then you put it on here together with this here, and you just chop it all up. That's what I've done on the other one that I just cooked in the oven. And I chop this as much as I can, you know, chop it. Then I get this here and put it in the cup with this other thing stuff here. And I'll put the roast back on here. And what I'll do, I get that the stuff and shove it inside there. Shove it inside these cavity with the garlic. The garlic, you shove it in the inside here, and usually you put them in, after you do that, you put it in the refrigerator overnight, and there will, this whole piece of meat will take the flavor of the garlic and the rosemary, okay? For this year, it's probably enough, and I want to get all the garlic out of there. So you shove it in here like that. Then you do the same with this little thyme seasoning. Little thyme seasoning, you put it inside here. Okay, and there's salt and pepper, garlic, and everything is in here, see? It's right inside here. Then what you do, you shove it in this same bag that you came in. You shove it in here and close it up. And you pop it in the refrigerator overnight. That's the best way of doing it. It's put it in the refrigerator overnight in that bag like that there, and you're ready to go. Now the next morning, you want to cook it. If you want to eat around 2 or 3 o'clock, it takes a long time for this to cook. Don't try to rush it within a half hour. You cannot cook pork within a half hour. That's why a lot of time people doesn't know that. They want to cook a pork chop or a roast in an hour and a half before they eat. It gets tough. It gets so tough that sometimes you cannot eat it because, why this pork is so tough? Every part of the pig, if you cook it right, it melts in your mouth when you can put it in the sand. Okay, so how you start cooking? We put this in a little pan, okay? Don't put nothing in the pan, but just set it in the pan like that. Turn your oven on at 400 degrees. That's important that you put that on 400 degrees. What it does, it browns the outside of the pork roast, the pork roast. Otherwise, it just, all the juice comes out of it and it becomes stuffed. You do that for about a half hour. I will take half hour at 400 degrees for this one here, okay? Then you turn the oven down to 325 for the next half hour while it's in the pan. Don't tell me why, but it's what the recipe said, so that's what I'm telling you. And then when you get to test what I cooked, I went exactly according to that recipe, okay? Then the good part comes. The good, and you lower it again to just 180. 180 degrees. This is the secret of making it really tender, the sherry wine. That's the first time I used this wine to cook this pork, because I didn't even know Bob used it in the 60s. And I said, where am I going to find that now? But unfortunately, I went to a liquor store, $8. $8 for a big bottle, they're only using one cup, okay? But what you do, you put that all over, about a cup, all over this roast right here like that, okay? And while it's in the pan, okay, you turn down the oven to 180. Now the pork comes. It would take 2.5 to 3 hours to cook that right at 180 degrees, but 3 hours. It says 20 minutes for each pound of pork roast. So each pound of pork roast takes 20 minutes of a pound and 180 in the oven. So after you leave it in here that long, you get it out, you could slice it, and you could put it on a sandwich. It just melts in your mouth. You could do not just this particular roast, but you can use it on pork chops. You can use it on any kind of pork and tenderize the meat. But I think this made the trick, because it not only smells good, because this is a little nutty wine. I mean, it's made out of, you know, grape juice, but also has flavor of some kind of nuts in it, you know. So it smells really good. You ought to smell that. It smells like, you know, a walnut or chestnut or whatever. But that's just a really good smell if you guys want to smell. But that's the first time. And I will use this all the time. And I drank it. It's good even to drink it. So this is my presentation today. As I said, the recipe is in the book. And also, if you want to read a little bit about my story, where I was raised and brought up, that's in the book also. The story is in here in the first couple of pages. Any question? While we have a question, I want to show you the finished product. Can I see that finish? Okay, this... we're going to get to eat that. Don't worry about it. So you'll have to tell me. I cooked it yesterday, and I started cooking around 9:30 in the morning. I didn't get it out of the oven until 3:30. And then night's only been in the warmer today. But you'll have to tell me how it is. And you probably want to make it all the time. But I want somebody to smell that. Smell. Smell. So you're going to get to try some of that.
Good job, Tony. You're awesome.
Any question? I know I heard somebody question. Well, it's the pork loin here. That's the pork loin. It's a little bit better meat than pork, but it's a lot more fat. But Italian people like fat sandwiches. So, yeah, we love fat. If you go capicola, it's all fat. You know, prosciutto is all fat. Salami is all fat. So this is a much, much leaner meat. I didn't want to make anybody fat today. So, so thanks a lot, and enjoy the rest of the day. We get to eat together.
I have the ensalada caprese, a very, very simple, nutritious salad from the island of Capri off the coast of Naples in Italy. Little history with the salad, very simple, and it was created by a stonemason after World War I. He wanted to create a dish that depicted the Italian flag, so red, white, and green. And this salad, like, it is the simplest summer salad that you can make, which is very, very basic ingredients. And I'm gonna start with the tomatoes. And the nice thing about the nutrition in the caprese salad, each vegetable, the cheese, the olive oil, it makes, everything has its own quality with the salad. The tomatoes have lycopene, which is a antioxidant. And you just slice the tomatoes down, thicker slices if you want. I'm gonna do several of them because we're gonna make a plate of it. The cheese that you use is mozzarella. And it is a healthy fat, believe it or not, in mozzarella. And we're using the slices. So I'm going to do this without taking off my fingers. And what I do, I just kind of get them ready to layer on the plate. This mozzarella is already pre-sliced. But just move this aside. Just to give you an idea how you start with it, take your slices and your slices of mozzarella, and you're going to just start layering tomato and cheese and tomato and cheese. Maybe bigger slices of cheese. And like I said, this, there's no measurements. You can use as many tomatoes as you want. Red, white, and green. So I have tomato for you. We eat this a lot in the summer. Fresh tomatoes from the garden. If you have the heirloom tomatoes, it's even better. But we are in Ohio, and we have Ohio tomatoes. That's what the label said. Ohio tomatoes. So you just want to start and just, and you can make it for a crowd, you can make it just individual. I'm just going to do half a tray for you so you can see. Tomatoes and cheese. The recipe calls for just salt and pepper, but we're Italian, and you have to have garlic salt. So instead of regular salt, we use some garlic salt. And just sprinkle. We're really Italian. We're going to get some more. So that's with the salt. A little bit of ground pepper. You can use coarse ground pepper. You can use the restaurant grind. This is just the table grind, which is the fine. There was a lot of that. So the next thing you want to do is you're going to use your extra virgin olive oil. And all it calls for is just a quick drizzle of the olive oil over the tomatoes and cheese, and then fresh basil. And the fresh basil, you just want to chop it. You can tear it, you can cut it with the scissors, whatever means you want. These are really big leaves. Sprinkle that basil over the top. Red, white, and green, just like the Italian flag. So you can use it like that. You can eat it just like that, or to make it the authentic caprese salad, balsamic vinegar. Just a splash. That is it. So this is a 5-minute salad, really, that you can make. It doesn't look really good on the yellow plate, but that is what you have. And that is your traditional caprese salad. So to change it up, and, you know, the caprese salad, you can do it all kinds of different ways. You can add things to it. You can add artichokes. You can add olives. You can add capers. So you can make it, personalize it, make it whatever you like. You can also use the cherry tomatoes. And that is what we're serving you today, with the cherry tomatoes. So this salad is made with cherry tomatoes and the mozzarella pearls, the torn basil, and it'll have the same dressing on it. It'll have the garlic and the olive oil and the balsamic vinegar. So this is another way that you can do it if you want to do it for a crowd. It takes a lot of time to slice these little tomatoes, so it's kind of helpful to have people that can slice them for you. But this is the other way that you can serve the salad. So, any questions? This was a hard one.
Recipe of the day. Not only is it the last, it's the easiest. Only 4 ingredients: alcohol, lemon, sugar, and water. I'm going to make an Italian liqueur, a lemon liqueur called limoncello. It is not limoncello. There used to be an Italian here. Everybody'd order limoncello. He'd go, limoncello. He said, damn Americanos. Anyway, you need, I found the big lemons. They're hard to find, the bigger ones. If you got this size, I use about 6 of them. If you got the smaller ones, I use maybe 8, 9 of them. Big ones, I was surprised I found the big ones. I already peeled 5 of them. Take 6 of them. When you peel it, you peel your lemon. I use a potato peeler. You do it real light. You don't want to press down real hard on it. So when it comes out, there's very little white on it. You don't want the white because it makes it bitter. So you peel 6 of those. Then you add the alcohol, Everclear, grain alcohol, 151 proof. You take the alcohol, pour it over those lemon peels, and you let it set for 48 hours, 2 days. So what is it, 4:15? So Tuesday at about 4:15, you take an equal amount of water, which is 1/5 of water. I think that's the alcohol. This might be the water. One of them. Yep, this is the water. I could taste it and find out. You pour the water in there. And then you put it on your stove. When it comes to a boil, you'll add 3 cups of sugar. As it's boiling, you add 3 cups of sugar. What I do, I just pour a little bit in at a time. Stir it till it dissolves. Just keep doing that till you got 3 cups completely dissolved. Once that's dissolved, you take your alcohol and you drain it to get rid of those lemon peels. And then you would add the water to it. And that's your limoncello. Very simple. You've got to add, 1 bottle will make 2/5. You just take it. I use this, I put that on the 5th, Just use a little cup and put it in your bottle. Once you're done, you put it in a freezer. It will not freeze because you want to serve it really, really cold. Once it gets warm, it's very, very sweet tasting. It's not as good. And we're going to give you samples of it. Now, you got shot glasses on your table. When people get a shot glass, they always want to shoot it. This liqueur, you sip it. Don't shoot it. You shoot it, you're going But you sip it, it tastes a lot better if you sip it. And if you have kids at home, I leave this set out for 2 days uncovered. You don't want to leave it on your table if you got a lot of kids, because they think it's lemonade. They may sleep good at night, but I find, at the store, I found little glasses like this. It's good to serve in something like this. But so that's about it. It's pretty easy. And if you got any questions, wait. No, it's a grain alcohol. Now, people, I've seen recipes where it can be made with vodka. You can use different things to make it. But the recipe was given to me by Greg Bazzari. I don't know, some of you might know Greg. But he's the one that gave me the recipe, and it always called for Everclear, so that's what I've always used. But I've seen people make it with vodka. And you can make it with about any. I've seen strawberry cello and orange cello, so you can make it with about anything. Sip. Don't forget to sip.